In the previous videos of this series, we have set up everything. We flashed the challenge secure file system onto the board and figured out how to interact with it over a serial connection. We also learned about using PySerial to speak with the embedded device via a Python script. This means we are ready to solve some challenges. So when you connect the board with this challenge loaded on it, you can see the following output on the serial console. It shows a list of files, and our goal is probably to read the passwd file. But let's first read the challenge description. Secure file system. We don't remember why, but we wanted a file system on an AVR328P, that's the microcontroller on the Arduino board. After the system was completed, we discovered that it lacked basic security. A couple of beers later, we came up with what we think is a revolutionary way to do file system permissions. It is now your task to fill in our shoes and test its security. The file system allows you to request the contents of one or more available files by using the following format. A token followed by a hash symbol and then at least one file name, followed by multiple optional file names, colon separated. And there are multiple example requests to read different files. For example, this one here would return the content of cat.txt and finances.csv. We already successfully did that in the previous video. So while I'm pretty certain what the solution will be, let's have a look at the other examples and approach it with an open mind, because maybe it's not what I think it is. The first thing we should notice is that the tokens look pretty random, especially when you compare different tokens that all request cat.txt. But in combination with other files, it will completely change. This means it's unlikely that data is encoded in there, or that it follows a predictable pattern that we could analyze statistically. It's very likely that it is a hash, like a password hash. Easy to compute and verify, but really hard to reverse. From the length, I suspect it to be a SHA1 hash. I didn't record this, but at this moment we could check if the file name or the combination of the multiple file names are simply hashed and that becomes a token, but it turns out it's not. And at this point I wanted to try out what I suspected to be the solution, because if you see a token that presumably protects or authenticates some data, it might be some kind of MAC, message authentication code. A MAC, or how it's here called, a token, can be used to prevent somebody else from changing data, and we don't know how to generate a valid token to request the passwd file. But a message authentication code can be implemented in a weak way, and then you can mess with it. And I actually introduced this weakness in a previous CTF video, so let me play that clip. Now, a very weak MAC implementation would simply do the following. It would take the secret key and append the message it wants to authenticate, and then creates an MD5 hash of the whole string. Next time it will receive a message and this MAC, it can then take the secret key again, append the message, calculate the hash, and compare it to the MAC. If that's the same, the message is trusted. This way, only somebody who knows the secret key can calculate a correct hash. Well, here comes the mind-blowing part. MD5 is vulnerable to a length extension attack. What does that mean? MD5 length extension attack basically means that we can add more characters to a string and update the hash so that it stays valid. In this case, we have an unknown secret key with some characters we control afterwards, and we know the hash of one valid message. You would think you need the secret key to calculate the new hash, but we can simply take the already computed hash and the valid message we know, and then extend it and update the hash. Obviously, it's not as simple. There are a few pitfalls if you would completely implement it yourself, like padding, and you would have to understand how MD5 is computed. But we will now just use a tool to do it for us. The tool is called HashPump. In that video, it was about an MD5 hash, but SHA1 hash has the same issue. If we assume that the embedded device has a secret key which is prepended to the requested file names, and then a hash is calculated around it, we should be able to attack this with a length extension attack. So let's start to write our attack script and use HashPump. We import PySerial, set up the serial connection with the USB serial device, then we can attempt to read from it, write one of the example tokens which should allow us to read the cat.txt, and then read again to get the content. But when we run it, it doesn't work. We read nothing. I assume that we read data too fast and the board is just too slow with sending. So I write a little helper function called readUntil, which always reads data from the serial connection until the read data contains the string we expect. So now we can read until the prompt appears. When we now test it, it will take a second until the board sends us something, but we are eventually able to read the content. Then I install hashpump in the Python module hashpump p. This allows easy access to the hashpump utility from a Python script. One problem with this is that a hash length extension attack has to know how long the secret key is, and we don't know that. But we can simply write a for loop that just tries out all different lengths, and then we simply call the hashpump function. We give it the hash we have, the data we know, the data we want to append. In this case, we want to append the passwd file with colons. Also, we don't know what is in pepper, so we get that file as well. At last, we need the key length. Hashpump will return the updated hash and the new message, which contains the padding and so forth. We can also print the tested key length with the data, so we can later see how long the secret key was. Then we send the new calculated updated token with the hash symbol and the colon separated file request via serial to the board. Then we should read until the next prompt after each attempt, so we know the board is ready to get our next request. Now we let it run and watch. Ah, there it looked like there was something. Let's scroll back up. Yeah, and there it is, the flag. Let's submit the flag and collect our first 100 points. Awesome.